Well, hi, folks. I'm Jack Kaye from NASA headquarters, and what I was going to do was to show you some of the things that we're seeing from space when we look at the Earth, but also by starting out with a little bit about how it is that we get the data that we've been showing you and will continue to show. This shows, especially if I don't stand in front of the words, the orbiting fleet that we have. It's more or less up to date. This shows the satellites that we have orbiting the Earth and getting the results that you'll be seeing. Most of these are in low Earth orbit, you know, 7 to 100 plus or minus kilometers above the Earth, orbiting the Earth every 90 to 100 minutes, so it's 15-ish orbits per day. Most are in polar orbits. So what that means is, with the satellite observations, for the first time in human history, we have more or less equivalent quality data anywhere in the world. I'll come back to that point. When you first look at this, it may look a little, like the bowl of boiling spaghetti or something. The orbits are everywhere, but there's actually a logic to it. So most are in near polar orbits, so you're over each pole, which gives great coverage of the poles. Some are in mid-inclination orbits. A lot are sort of look like they're on their own. Some travel together. That's the A-Train constellation, where we build up the satellites over a period of years to get near simultaneous observations in ways that one never could. Cygnus represents the 8 Cygnus satellites that were launched during the AGU meeting last year. Then you can sort of work our way out to the L1 Lagrange point where Discover is. At some point, if I keep talking, it may come back. But the two things to really want to emphasize is sort of the ubiquity of the coverage that we get of the entire Earth, again, more or less, because to a good approximation, the data are just as good anywhere as they are anywhere else, albeit accounting for making sure that you do the appropriate calibration and validation and algorithm tests under the different geophysical or biogeochemical conditions. Something else to point out is, especially if you're a lapsed theorist like me, the quality of the engineering that goes into this stuff. We make it look easy, and you know, we show the orbits and understand it's, you know, from the full force of the sun on the satellite for half the orbit to the coldest, darkest night of space with almost instantaneous transitions, 15 times a day, day after day, year after year. You know, we've got satellites that, if they were people, they'd be old enough to vote, maybe old enough to drink. Just the engineering that goes into it, you know, and to run the A-Train constellation is really enormous. And as a scientist, sometimes we forget to do that. And I want to sort of do the shout out for the engineers. Next is to show you some of the things that we're seeing. This represents the 20 years of biosphere data. And it shows the biosphere both on land and in the ocean. You can see the color scale in the lower right-hand corner there. And for once, I'm not actually standing in front of it. This is a lot of Seaworth's data, MODIS data, whatever we're using. And this is sort of the natural Earth as we expect it to be. You know, the green forest, brown deserts, white snow. In the ocean, you can see the red areas of high productivity along the coast, the areas. But this is the Earth. It's almost like a living, breathing organism, because you can see, where photosynthesis is taking place and where the Earth is doing its natural thing. Next is a very different view of the Earth. This is the Earth at night. This is what we would call the black marble. Using the VIRS day-night band aboard the SUMI NPP satellite. And here, what you see is where we're really impacting the Earth. Because before, I could show you the natural Earth. Here you see where we are. You see, and where the lights are on at night, that's typically where you've got large concentrations of people and sort of large industrial infrastructure, because that's literally what it takes to keep the lights on at night. So, you know, in the U.S., you can pretty much see the cities. You can see in so much of the world how the population is localized along the coasts. And some cases, you'll be able to see where you may have fishing, where you may have some industrial activity. But this is, it's a great way of looking at human geography here. Think back, the last one sort of showed a natural Earth, and here you can see where we are and we're impacting the planet. And in some cases, you can even see boundaries. Look at the difference between South Korea and North Korea. A lot more lights on in South Korea than North Korea. So again, and this idea of the interplay between the natural Earth and what humans are doing, I think is a big theme with what we're doing is part of looking at the Earth as an integrated system. Next, shows another example of how we're literally changing the Earth. This is 40 years of Landsat data for Las Vegas, Nevada. You can see the time slider up at the top and watch the metropolitan area build its way out. The airport is a good marker to use. As you can see, sort of the subdivisions increase and and then, you know, thanks to the magic of computer visualization, if you couldn't remember what it was like 40 years ago, they'll do it for you. But an important thing is that this isn't just pretty picture. This is quantitative scientific data that we can use to address things like, what will it mean for urban heat islands? What does it mean when precipitation falls? Where will the water run off? Where will the weather sink in? What about albedo? What about interactions of radiation with the surface? This is quantitative data for use, and I'm showing Las Vegas, but you know, one could do similar kinds of things in other metropolitan areas, and getting this idea that that you can get good data other places. Next. Shows some of the ways the Earth is changing. This is the Arctic sea ice extent. You can see at the September minimum where the coverage is. You can see the curve that shows how the Arctic sea ice minimum extent is changing. 2007, you had the big decrease. 2012, you had another big decrease, and then it sort of came back to work its way down. And if you sort of look here and you see at the September minimum, over the time, areas that at the beginning of the record were covered with ice at the end of the summer, now you're beginning to see a lot less ice coverage. And, you know, maybe they're not quite at the Northwest Passage stage yet, but I think I do get stuff in the mail about taking Northwest Passage cruises. I'm not going to do it, and I can't afford it anyway. But, you know, this is an example of the fact that, you know, the Earth is changing, and this is one of those things, if you didn't have satellites, I don't know how you could even begin to contemplate how you would be able to do this, to be able to see it, get the frequent coverage, and get it in an absolutely quantitative way that's very rigorous. Next. Okay, this is one of these big things. So you see there's precipitation. It's an important part of the Earth is, you know, where is the rain falling, because the water is so central to what we do. And with our partners in Japan, we launched the GPM satellite a couple of years ago, and we can get precipitation fields, and working with constellation satellites, try to get 3-hour precipitation data. And you're getting it, especially with GPM, which represents a significant advance over its twin predecessor, higher inclination orbit. We're getting snow as well as rain, but we're getting precipitation over land, over the ocean. So we can look at not just where is precipitation falling, but how does precipitation contribute to the global water and energy cycle? And again, this idea that, you know, some people might say, does it really matter? Well, if it rains over the ocean, well, yeah, that can help control ocean salinity. And if I showed the data from Aquarius, you'd be able to see the sea surface salinity, which is important for the ocean, for the Earth as an integrated system. Next. Shows another way of looking at what we're doing to the surface. And you see I'm kind of bouncing back between what we do and what the Earth does. This shows nitrogen dioxide that's measured usually the mainly we get it from the OMI instrument aboard the Aura satellite. It's a great example of the way we work internationally. OMI was built in the Netherlands with contributions from Finland. It's flying on the Aura satellite, but really the whole approach of using UV to look at NO2 from space was pioneered by our colleagues in Europe with the Scamacci instrument aboard ESA's Envisat. But we can look at NO2 and see where you've got a lot of fossil fuel combustion or occasionally some other forms of combustion. You can see areas of high pollution. And if you look over time, you'll be able to see changes in ways that you actually can look. You know, Aura was launched in, guess what, 2000, for, and you can actually see over that time period how the, in some cases, the pollution control strategies have caused NO2 amounts to decrease. You can see areas like in China where they've increased. You can see where some areas have started to decrease, and really be able to see the connection between what we're doing at the surface and the fact that the atmosphere reflects it in very clear ways. And there's a lot of creative work that people have done with OMI. Next. This is aerosols. This is using the GS5 model from Gather that shows aerosols, and aerosols are a great way of looking at natural and human activities, how they come together. And when it gets into the atmosphere, you could say the atmosphere is the great integrator and transporter, because you've got different varieties of aerosols that are represented here in different colors. Sea salt aerosols, kind of in blue, sulfur aerosols, sulfate aerosols, like from coal combustion, in white, organic and black carbon that tends to come from biomass burning in green, and mineral desert dust in orange. You can see how it's blown. You can see how complicated the aerosol picture is, because they come together. Stuff gets transported. What blows off the east coast of Asia can reach the U.S. What blows off the U.S. can reach Europe. And, it's all one atmosphere. But you get the sense it's really complicated. And this is, what happens when you combine observations and models in an integrated way. You can really begin to look at things in a quantitative way, which, until recently one would not be able to do. It's taken advances in observations and computational modeling to be able to do stuff like this. And besides that, it's just really pretty. Next. So what I wanted to do is just sort of look back. And this is 60 years of Earth observation. In January, we'll be celebrating 60 years of Earth observations from the launch of Explorer 1. So what you have here is a sense of looking at the way that the orbits of our NASA-related Earth science spacecraft have done. So early on, there's not a lot. So they have to speed it up in order for me to get done for Don Wobbles to start on time. Actually, they did it for other reasons, but this is a very good reason. It says 1:53. So now, by the time you get to 1964, you can see you get to some other things, and there's a little timeline up there, probably blocking some of the highlights there. But you can see some of the things that that have been done in the way of looking at the Earth as a system. And it's there. You see, you've got Apollo 8. But when you step back and think about it, you realize just what an enormous impact this has had, I think, both in terms of the way we view our home planet and, from the point of view of science. It's just opened up so many lines of study that's, rigorously based, that's, quantitative, and especially the idea that that's global, and that we can look at the Earth as an integrated system. We can look at the multiple Earth system components. We can look at how they interact with each other. We can look at what nature does, and we can look at what we do. We look at the forcings to the Earth, natural and human induced. We look at the mechanisms by which the Earth responds, and then we can characterize what the implications of those changes are, what it means now, with the goal of developing improved predictive capability for the future. If you want to hear more, there's a union session tomorrow afternoon, 4:00, I guess in E2, on 60 years of Earth observations. So if you like this, come back, and then you can hear all about it from the people who are doing the real work, and can share the joy and excitement, and hopefully have a lot of time for audience participation and discussions. Thank you very much, and